Okay, we are live. Welcome to the Lovecraft eZine Sunday show. Today is June the 8th, 2014, and Mr. Kenneth Hite is on the show today. Thanks for coming on, Ken. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Mike. Glad to be along.
As usual, we got Rick and Pete here. Thanks, guys. You know, I like to start off with, I think a lot of, especially Lovecraft fans out there know who you are, Ken, but for those that are watching that don't, could you kind of start at the beginning and say who you are and what you do, why that matters to Lovecraft fans?
Well, I'm not going to necessarily tell them why it matters, but I am I'm a role-playing game designer first and foremost. That's sort of my main gig. I've designed, among other games, Trail of Cthulhu, which is a licensed adaptation of Call of Cthulhu to the Gumshoe system. I did that for Pograin Press in 2008. I've written a number of source books for that. I've also written a book called Tour to Lovecraft, which is sort of somewhere in the line between blog comments and literary criticism, or criticism of criticism, maybe. Mm-hmm. Tour to Lovecraft, The Tales, which came out from Atomic Overmind, also, I think, in 2008, so I guess that was a good year for me. And I've written a number of things for Lovecraftians since then. I've got 3 Lovecraftian children's books out. Where the Deep Ones Are, The Antarctic Express, and Clifford the Big Red God. And I've also written the Lost in Lovecraft column for Weird Tales since, I guess, 2010, although under the new regime, I'm not exactly sure, you know, when publishing resumes or when my column resumes, if it does. But, you know, being a columnist in Weird Tales is a pretty good gig, so.
I don't even think I've heard of Tour de Lovecraft. I'm sorry. Can you talk a little bit about that? Because that sounds very interesting.
Tour to Lovecraft is basically when I was writing Trail of Cthulhu, I went back and I reread everything by Lovecraft to make sure that I could get as much of that material and as much of that sensibility, the Lovecraft sensibility, into the game as I could. Mm-hmm. And I, just to, you know, get it put down somewhere, I sort of blogged my reaction to each of the stories on my live journal at the time. And a bunch of the people on the live journal said, "You should put all this together as a book because I've never read anything that sort of just lays out Lovecraft from sort of an educated beginner's perspective, right? It's sort of the coming back to Lovecraft type approach." And one of the people who said that was Hal Mangold, who is my publisher. And so, you know, when he said it, he had a check behind it, so that made it a great deal more sensible. So I sort of put the columns together, rewrote them, brought stuff that had been brought out in the blog comments up into the main text, you know, fixed a couple of errors, added an introduction and a history of Lovecraftian criticism to sort of situate my book in context, and it got released to moderate acclaim, I guess, in 2008. So that's what that is. At some point, the Lost in Lovecraft columns that I've been doing for Weird Tales and some of the other sort of long-form Lovecraftian criticism that I've done here and there, that'll probably get assembled into a second volume of Tour to Lovecraft once either I finish the Weird Tales stuff or something else happens. But I assume that that'll be in the next couple of years that we get that put together. But it's sort of the opening bit of a long-form, quasi-critical, I guess you could call it, discussion.
Well, I'm going to have to pick that up. While you were talking, I just looked it up. Just talking to the audience now, it is available on Amazon, Tour to Lovecraft. Yeah. Kenneth Hite, so yeah, I'll be buying that later today. That definitely looks like it's worth picking up. Thank you.
See if I have a copy in this giant rack of garbage, but I don't think I do.
Yeah, I was telling Ken before we went live that we all love his background of books there. Hey, Jeremy. What is it about... You probably answered this question a million times. What is it about Lovecraft and cosmic horror that fascinates you? Answer's probably different for all of us, but...
Well, I mean, part of it is just that Lovecraft is a really terrific writer, and once he gets his sort of, you know, once he's, you know, taken up a spot in your brain, you don't get to evict him. He's got lifelong settler's rights there. So that's one of those things that I think just the power and the skill of his writing is what keeps me coming back to it over and over again, just like, you know, you'd come back to Dashiell Hammett or any other really, really good writer. But
I'm sorry, can I stop you there real quick? Because I even had this debate recently. I you see online, you see people say, well, you know, Lovecraft had these great ideas, but man, was a terrible writer, which I strongly disagree with.
Of course,
and
you
first thing you just said was, you know, you Lovecraft's a really good writer. I mean, what do you? Mm-hmm. What's your answer to those people? Or, you know, the purple prose comments and all that stuff.
Well, I mean, these people are not, you know, they're not to be blamed. They were brought up and probably educated in a environment in which the modernist ideal of transparent prose and character-driven fiction was presented as the only way to write, mm-hmm. in much the same way that Lovecraft believed that the only way to write was with involuted detail, with a lot of verisimilitude of setting, and with a vocabulary that was each piece of it is picked to produce a specific emotional coloring or a specific emotional response. Lovecraft's sort of painterly writing is not valued anymore because, you know, literary trends shift. Anyone who's read anything written in a century they don't live in has sort of noticed that, one hopes. And, you know, but the fact is that writing teachers generally don't know very much about writing, and so they teach the text, and the text has been modernism. And, you know, most people who grow up reading nothing but modernism find it difficult to read outside that, just like I assume most people who would have grown up in the 19th century found it difficult to read the moderns. And that's why when we read that people were, like, you know, having fistfights over whether or not Hemingway was a good writer, it's just the same thing in reverse, or Fitzgerald. And then they say, but this story, it's so clear and direct, and nothing really happens in it, and it's all about the interior life of the character. What kind of fiction is that? That's nonsense. Fiction is incident, and it's incident colored with emotion and brought in from a setting that we know and understand. And that's not how fiction has been for the last 80 to 100 years, although that's changing, obviously, mm-hmm. Mostly with the magic realists and the Latin Americans beginning to sort of change the way that literary professors teach literature, at least, which will hopefully filter down to grade school teachers at some point. But the, you know, Lovecraft was a person who had a specific literary style that he developed mostly by reading Dunsany and Hawthorne. And if you've read Dunsany and Hawthorne, you can sort of see where Lovecraft is getting at. And no one is, you know, no one is lining up and saying, Nathaniel Hawthorne is a terrible writer, although he does the exact same things that Lovecraft does, because they're doing it the same way. I mean, Lovecraft is not as great as Hawthorne by any stretch of the imagination, but he's a terrific writer.
Ken, you mentioned Dashiell Hammett, mm-hmm. and yeah, I often make the comparison to Lovecraft and the pulp crime writers, in the sense that what Lovecraft is doing is actually building and solving a mystery.
Yeah.
That,
I mean, that's
what happens to be millions of years old and involve monsters.
Yeah, I mean, that's sort of the key insight of Trail of Cthulhu, is that it privileges the sort of mystery-solving aspect of the Lovecraftian of the Lovecraftian experience, whether that's the Call of Cthulhu game or whether that's Lovecraft's actual stories. But they're all about what's going on here. And in a proper Lovecraft universe, of course, discovering that answer destroys you. But in, you know, a gameable universe, discovering that answer merely propels you into a deeper mystery that eventually destroys you.
Now, I interrupted you a little bit talking about his style of writing and what some people say about it. Can you continue a little bit about what draws you into Lovecraft and cosmic horror? What fascinates you about it?
I mean, part of it is that I think that there's a degree of, I mean, Joshi's not wrong when he says that the philosophical depth of cosmic horror is makes it more interesting than a story that doesn't have any particular philosophical depth to it. I don't think that that's the end-all and be-all, but I think that, you know, as a Calvinist, I respond well to narratives of utter abasement and cosmic dereliction. That's sort of, you know, a tone that I that plucks, I guess, inside of me to an extent. Also, the scope is great. I mean, Lovecraft's universe is our universe, unbounded by time and space, because that's what he wrote. That's what he wanted to write. And looking out over that vast scope and seeing that Lovecraft managed to build a horror that simultaneously threatens and transcends it, that's just an amazing thing to even contemplate, much less get to play around in the sandbox of, which is, you know, what I guess what all of us do to one degree or another. And then, you know, the actual chrome, the sort of the fittings, the details, the way that he, you know, puts together a cargo cult without knowing anything about cargo cults to build the Order of Dagon in Innsmouth. All the little intricate backstories that got us all fascinated when we were 11, the Necronomicon and Abdul al-Hazred and globe-spanning cults and a secret castle in Romania that blows up when maybe Merlin blows it up, we don't know. All those sorts of loose ends and little pieces that Lovecraft left around to deliberately make his universe interesting and seem knit together without actually knitting it together. Guess what? That worked. He was very good at that, too. He was, you know, as good as he was at sort of the high literature aspect that the Joshi and people like him appreciate, he was also really good at the low literature. I mean, there's a reason that, you know, I mentioned him with Hammett and maybe with Owen Wister. Those three guys created virtually all of popular culture as we understand it now. And if you want to look at anything in American and even Western popular culture, you're going to find out, it's going to be very hard to separate anything that isn't informed by one of those three writers. And Lovecraft just did a really great job of it, in the same way that Wister built a mythical West that then, you know, Max Brand and Louis L'Amour did, built onto, and that Hammett built a new heroic urban existence in the way that Raymond Chandler, but also, you know, a lot of the modernist writers like Bukowski or Raymond Carver even built onto, because they have that same continental op look at the world and that same notion of it. And then that gradation through crime fiction is more obvious, because the distance between crime fiction and horror literature has not always been, or the distance between crime fiction and literature, capital L, has not always been as hard to breach for a lot of people as the difference between horror and literature, capital L, or science fiction, or westerns.
You mentioned, Trail of Cthulhu, which I wanted to ask you about as well,
yeah.
And Gumshoe. Now, I'm going to ask you these questions from the perspective of a guy who, just a few months ago, started playing Call of Cthulhu, which is, I think, actually a good way to ask, because so many people out there are probably in my position. So dumb question number one. What's the difference between playing a regular game of Call of Cthulhu, one of those scenarios, and playing Trail of Cthulhu? And what's the Gumshoe system? What are those differences? What are those things?
Okay, the fundamental sort of core mechanic of the Gumshoe system is that there's two kinds of challenges in any game. And there's the kind of challenge where failure makes the game slow down and become less interesting, and there's the kind of challenge where the failure makes the game speed up and become more interesting,
okay.
Right? And a challenge that makes the game slow down or stop or become less interesting is the one where you don't find the diary, you don't find the footprints, you don't understand what the blood means, you don't ever hear the mystical piping that brings you into the hills behind the town, right? You don't pick up the thread that leads you to the next part of the story, into the next scene. And if you, obviously, you were talking about it as a mystery before, in all mysteries, the detective, or at least the reader, is able to move from scene to scene and follow the thread of the narrative. That's the whole reason that it's a narrative as opposed to a police report, which don't work that way either.
Right.
But in Call of Cthulhu, for example, if you blow a spot hidden roll and the keeper is not Johnny on the spot, you might be spending 45 minutes or an hour trying to figure out another way into the secret room. And if you just made the spot hidden roll, you could have gotten into the secret room and had some kind of horrible discovery there. So in the Gumshoe system, you never fail an investigative roll, right? There's two kinds of abilities, investigative abilities, which never fail, and general abilities, which shooting the monster, failing that makes the story really interesting really fast, right?
Right.
So those are the kinds of things that you might fail at, you know, gunplay, running away, remaining sane in the sight of something horrific. And that kind of failure is the kind of thing that amps up drama, or creates drama, and creates interesting narrative. And so those are just like every other role-playing game you've ever played. You roll to hit, or you roll to succeed, or you roll to resist, and you make it, you don't make it, we don't know. That's where the chance and the fun come in. So the Gumshoe system creates the mysteries by creating either a trail of clues in the most obvious and straightforward way, or I prefer to do it as sort of an ocean of clues, where as you move through them, you will find your way to the island at the center, and at the island of the center is where the great, the big reveal happens. And in Lovecraft's story, obviously, the big reveal is something really terrible. Mm-hmm. So the Trail of Cthulhu exists to optimize mystery solving and mystery investigation as that aspect of play.
The focus is more on this is a mystery.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. As a keeper, well, I want to ask your advice for keepers in general, but you personally as a keeper, is it more important to move the game along and help out the players if they don't quite get it, or do they need to figure it out on their own? You know.
Well, as a keeper, your job is to make the story, make the experience a scary, Lovecraftian, horrifying experience.
Right.
And for me, that implicates and implies that you're going to have something horrible happen, that there's going to be ghouls or deep ones or serpent people or a vision of Yog-Sothoth or something awful is going to happen. And the longer you take not doing that, the less satisfying the experience is, both for you and for the players. And so there may be some sort of, rules of baseball way in which if they don't honestly make a roll, you know, then it won't mean as much when they're attacked by deep ones. But you're not playing the game to establish, you know, some sort of championship or whatever. You're playing the game in order to experience this horrific sensation in this world of terrible reality. And the way to do that is to provide as much horror as you can and to sort of collaborate, ideally, with the players to build a narrative that is genuinely a scary and involving narrative. Now, in Call of Cthulhu, what that maybe means is that you're prepared for the point at which the thing might go off the rails, and so you immediately have another way for them to find it, or you use a mental, a die modifier, and you say, all right, if they miss it by 25, they'll still find it, because it's that obvious a clue. You know, it's a big blood spatter, they'll figure it out, or something like that. But, again, the game is not about real people doing real things. The game is about a Lovecraft story being expressed in a collaborative role-playing. So if you're saying, well, this does not simulate reality at all, it's like, yeah, neither do deep ones. That's not the point of what you're doing.
You know, what Ken is expressing in great language is something that's always frustrated me, is I see two really different kinds of keepers. Keepers who set themselves up to be the antagonist to the players and try to thwart their every movement, which often results in horrific gameplay. Because what's the point? If you kill off or severely damage all the characters before they get to even get to the dungeon, who wants to come and play again?
That's a really good point, Pete. And you know, sometimes we play on Ken, I don't know if you know, but we play here, not these guys, but me and some people play here on Tuesday nights and Friday nights, and inevitably we'll get comments on the message board, people watching, like, oh, nobody died. Well, yeah, but was it entertaining, though? That's the...
And that's the issue, is that a lot of the role-playing games are supposed to be narratives, particularly Call of Cthulhu and Trail of Cthulhu, where it is supposed to not only entertain the players, but the keeper as well. And if you can't even get to the story, it's not worth it. But if you keep the story going and keep it moving and put roadblocks in the way, but they're surmountable roadblocks, it's a lot of fun.
Well, I mean, even if they're insurmountable roadblocks, if there's a way around it or the confrontation with the insurmountability is the point, that's fine. But, you know, again, a lot of people got the antagonist, stance, I guess, from running Dungeons & Dragons, where that's a perfectly legitimate sort of, I am the Dungeon Master, you are the players, let's fight type approach.
Right,
and I
right.
played that when I was in grade school. I was playing Dungeons & Dragons that way, too. But when I started playing Dungeons & Dragons, when I started playing Call of Cthulhu, it's way too easy to kill all the players. There's no challenge in it.
Right?
It's like, oh, no, okay, there's three ghouls. Well, now you're really dead, right? You know, okay, the Shoggoth has 10 more hit points. There's no challenge in that kind of gameplay for me. So even with Call of Cthulhu, and I shouldn't say even with Call of Cthulhu, it's the greatest role-playing game ever designed, and I love it to death. It's absolutely the A number one game. But with Call of Cthulhu, it's more interesting and I think vastly more rewarding and certainly more possible, given all the magnificent stuff that Chaosium has produced for the game, to present a world of, you know, all-encompassing horror such that survival or victory for the individual characters, while making a as you say, a satisfying narrative, still does not implicate the universe in it, right? That all you've done, and you know that all you've done, is you've saved Arkham for, you know, a week, or, you know, maybe a month, or maybe a whole century. But, you know, you, the player, knows I'm literally the only thing standing in the way of utter destruction. And that is the realization that you should be going for, as far as I'm concerned, because that's the Lovecraftian revelation, except, of course, that Lovecraft says, oh, and I can't stand in the way, and bam, you know, there you go. But, you know, Lovecraft's stories also end with the world intact, I hasten to point out, because Lovecraft has to present them as artifacts of our real universe. So the, you know, the squaring the circle between Lovecraft and game representations of Lovecraft is not as difficult as a lot of purists would have you believe either. But certainly, the individual narrator is destroyed more often in Lovecraft than he is in a game, maybe.
Well, I think I've learned more about playing Call of Cthulhu in the last 5 minutes than the last 8 or 9 months of playing. Thanks. And those are really good points, too, Pete, the two different stances. I'd never thought about it that way before.
Well, you know, and just to kick a dead horse, you know, when I played D&D, the goal was to go to the dungeon, accumulate money, and gain experience points, right?
Mm-hmm.
The goal in Call of Cthulhu is to live another day. I mean, just to get by. There's no wealth or fortune or girls. Well, sometimes, but most of the time it's just getting by to the next day. Like Ken said, getting Arkham through to the next week.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. It's not about you getting through. It's about getting Arkham through. It's about saving other people. That's why Call of Cthulhu and its kindred games like Trail of Cthulhu are, you know, games about, you know, actual things that matter. They're games with a moral viewpoint. Right. Whereas Dungeons & Dragons and virtually all the other role-playing games, which I love and have, you know, given me a perfectly nice room full of crazy books, as you can see, those games are, as you say, they're about personal empowerment or escapism. They're just about, you know, I want to kill, you know, bad guys. I want to kill owlbears. I want to get gold. I want to be Superman. I want to do whatever. And there's nothing wrong with that. We all want to be Superman and kill owlbears, but for something to mean something, you have to be risking something, and that risk that you have to make is your own sanity and your own life, and why Call of Cthulhu is so great, and why I hope the Trail of Cthulhu is that great in you know, sporadic moments, is that it's always about that. Your character is fragile and can be destroyed, and the players who are sitting on the sidelines and saying, why was there no death, understand that too, even if they're watching it more in sort of a NASCAR spirit than in Lovecraft spirit. Mm-hmm. Right, waiting for the crashes, not so much enjoying the race.
Oh, yeah, that's well put. As I mentioned, Lovecraft eZine players, we play on Tuesdays and Friday nights. I would like to, David Burris on the message board right now said we should play some Trail of Cthulhu. Do you recommend starting with a particular game for people that are new to Trail of Cthulhu, or does it matter?
If you're new to it, there is a convention scenario that's out now, I think, in playtest that might be worth looking at. There is also a book of scenarios by Robin Laws, who's the designer of the Gumshoe system, called Stunning Eldritch Tales, which take different pulp genres and Cthulhu-fy them. So if your players are more used to sort of a pulpier mindset, this can sort of move them into understanding the Gumshoe system. Robin and I also collaborated on a book called Shadows Over Filmland, which takes 13 different horror movies of the 1930s and 40s and represents all of them as Cthulhu adventures. So there's... awesome. I did the Dracula one and the Mummy one, and Robin did the Werewolf one and the Invisible Man one, and Robin did a tremendously good tribute to the Val Lewton films. That is a really great, very scary adventure in which there may or may not be any actual Cthulhu mythos involvement at all. It's terrifically good. I tried to do something at least that good with my homage to Edgar Ulmer's The Black Cat, called The Black Chateau, in which you find yourself in a crazy modernist house somewhere in war-torn Eastern Europe, and you may or may not be in Carcosa. So it's that basic thing. So if your players are film fans or know those horror films, maybe that's a way to sort of drift them into it. Those are not necessarily all of them intro scenarios. I think Stunning Eldritch Tales is a good one for that. We have another couple of few on the Pelgrane Press website that might be worth looking at. They're all, you know, none of it is rocket science, for gosh sakes. It's you know, role-playing games. I don't think that we have a straightforward sort of go to the haunted house and find the ghost type adventure the way that Call of Cthulhu does in the core book, and maybe we need one. But a lot of them are fairly accessible, and I think the ones that I mentioned are really accessible for sort of, you know, new gamers or new gumshoe gamers.
Yeah. Did you say that title was Shadows Over Filmland?
Shadows Over Filmland.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Okay. My audience usually, I can picture everybody writing that down right now, because that's usually what happens.
I'm savoring at the mouth over these scenarios.
Yeah.
I'm just curious, but I mean, the ones I didn't expect were Val Lewton and the Black Cat, which was the Lugosi Karloff movie. Were there any other more obscure horror movies you used from the 30s?
Well, I did one that was based on the James Whale film The Green Hell, which is not really a horror movie except for one moment of perfect psychological horror about three-quarters of the way through. It's actually a jungle adventure movie. But I watched it. First of all, it's James Whale, so who doesn't love that? And then I watched it, and that moment of, you know, what are we all doing here? Are any of us actually human that he puts into it? Was such a great Lovecraftian moment that I thought, well, that's worthy. I think we can build something out of that. Let's see, what else are the other ones? The conclusion is Robin and I collaborated on an adventure set in a film studio that is trying to make a movie of The Call of Cthulhu without knowing what they're doing. And your job basically is to shut down the production. Let's see, what else is there? There's... The Most Dangerous Game, I think, is one of them. There's we did a monster rally where all the monsters from the other adventures come together.
Sort of a House of Frankenstein.
Yeah, sort of a House of Frankenstein type thing. Yeah, there's a lot of them. If you look online, I can't immediately recollect the whole table of contents right off the top of my head, but it's on there.
Let me say again, I love your book cave.
Thanks.
That's actually his office. See, when you go to be a professional writer like this, you get to have an office that looks like that.
It's a tax-deductible book cave.
Exactly.
That's what it is. Yeah. Yeah, my wife can't use this computer because she's worried that all the books are going to basically just fall in on her.
The worst problem is when you have to find a book that you haven't looked for in about a year.
Yeah, that
could be it. Which pile did you put it in?
Mm-hmm.
That's true.
Yeah, you know what layer in the archaeology is. You know.
Yes, I have the stratigraphy all worked down. I just need to, you know, do some core samples.
That's right.
You know, obviously August Derleth did us a tremendous service, but do you think that Lovecraft would be as popular as he is now? That said, if it wasn't for gaming,
I think that I think that after, you know, post Derleth, obviously you're talking about a different universe than you would have without Derleth.
Right.
I think, however, the Call of Cthulhu came along at a really critical moment for Lovecraft as a cultural phenomenon, and the fact that Call of Cthulhu comes out in 1981 and it sells at the time probably about 150,000, maybe 200,000 copies in 1981. And it is 2 years after that that Del Rey does Blood-Curdling Tales of Horror and the Macabre, that great omnibus collection with the Michael Whelan cover on it that we all saw. That book has never been out of print since. So before Call of Cthulhu, no Lovecraft paperback had ever stayed in print more than a year and a half.
Really?
Call of Cthulhu, it's not dropped out of print. The first collection that came out after Call of Cthulhu has never gone out of print since. So I think that you can look at that and say either there's just something in the water in 1981 that is making everyone start appreciating Lovecraft, some sort of, you know, global statute of limitations expires, or you can say, no, I think that actually putting that role-playing game into the hands of 250,000 nerds probably had a lot of impact in what happened to not just those nerds, people like me, although I knew about Lovecraft before the game, which is why I bought the game, but, you know, but also their friends, their game groups, you know, their buddies, their little brothers, their girlfriends, their well, kids.
I'm sure going, you know, what, where's all this come from? And, you know, yeah. They want to read more.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, and it's and I think that you saw for example, Chaosium plays a crucial role or played a crucial role in making the category of Cthulhu Mythos fiction. It's virtually the only saleable short story category left, right? Certainly in speculative fiction, and probably in all fiction. And Chaosium's anthologies produced, you know, kept those sort of fed that market and built it up to the extent that now. There is that expectation that a Cthulhu Mythos anthology, people say, well, of course that will sell. That was not assumed, right? I mean, you mentioned Derleth. Derleth went, you know, broke over and over and over trying to sell Cthulhu Mythos anthologies. And he, you know, he tried his best, which, you know, may or may not have been, you know, the best that anyone ever could have tried, but he was the only guy trying it.
Right.
And, you know, Lynn Carter's Heroic Ballantine Adult Fantasy series, the reason those are all selling for $100, it's not because they were super best sellers. Right? I mean, all this work was done, and then Call of Cthulhu comes along, and now the flowering. And you can say certainly Derleth and Lynn Carter nurtured that garden, but I think without gaming, you would not have seen it explode to the extent that you did now. And you can certainly make an argument, if you want to be snotty, you can say that the explosion did Lovecraft no favors because it, you know, produced a lot of terrible, terrible stuff. But terrible, terrible stuff was being produced while he was alive. I don't think that there's any... You know, great difference between pre and post in the term of the quality, just the number.
No, I agree with you, and I'm good friends with Sandy Peterson. I asked him a couple months ago, I said, as I'm lucky enough to live in the same area that mm-hmm. he lives in, I said, you know, I said, do you realize, Sandy, or have you thought about, you know, how much you exploded Lovecraft when you created that game? And he said, yeah. And his opinion was Stuart Gordon helped a lot, too. I don't know if he's being modest, because I disagree with him. I think Call of Cthulhu
mm-hmm.
did most of it. But
well, I mean, Reanimator didn't hurt. It did really well, but Stuart Gordon didn't really follow it up by, you know, building the Star Wars universe, did he? I mean, every one of his sequels did less well, and there hasn't been successful, you know, financially. I mean, let's leave artistically way off to the side, but there hasn't been a financially successful Lovecraft film, you know, possibly ever, but certainly not since Reanimator.
Yeah,
that's, I mean, except at the very, very kind of small scale that, you know, the Film Fest guys, I mean, they probably make all their money back over a course of decades, and maybe the HBO Historical Society is, you know, by dint of having a pre-existing market that they can sell right into, they're not losing money, but I don't think, you know, anyone's making money to the extent that even, you know, Roger Corman probably did off the, you know, off of his
Hornet
Expresses, yeah.
Well, no, but it's interesting to me how many people try.
Because it's so fascinating and wonderful and magnificent. I mean,
yeah.
To an extent, that's the same reason that Hollywood keeps greenlighting Westerns, even though up until True Grit, I don't think any of those had made more than $20 or $30 million.
I mean, I saw today or yesterday that someone has done an ebook of H.P. Lovecraft's the fragment Azathoth,
mm-hmm.
and is selling it for 99¢ a pop.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's going to be a lot of disappointed people in that. You know.
Well, you know, you pay for you caveat emptor, I guess.
If you know where to look, you can find all of Lovecraft. Probably all of Clark Ashton Smith and most of Robert E. Howard online for free.
Sure. Yeah, because it's all public domain.
Yeah.
But, you know, and you know, as we were talking earlier before the show started, as a proud Kindle owner, I'm happy to pay someone 99¢ to, you know, to fix the typos and, you know, justify the margins and do all the other stuff.
Right.
I have no problem with that. But buying just Azathoth might perhaps be a little much. But again,
yeah.
who goes and buys, you know, something that's, as you say, available online for free, and doesn't go and look at it and say, oh, well, that's, you know, that's a 600-page novel. I probably can bring 99¢ for that, as opposed to, that's a, you know, this is not even a 600-word, you know, short story, or short story fragment, you know. What am I going to do with that?
Yeah.
I have that on a T-shirt for less.
Well, wait, I heard you.
That's the mark. That's a marketing thing. We could do that.
Well, probably the first thing to do if you see something in Kindle that's 99 cents, first check if it's on Kindle for free, because you got a lot of those. Second, go to Internet Archive or Google Books and check if there's an e-text available of it. That's also for free.
Yeah. Ken, I think I saw somewhere that you're or heard that you're a film buff, and since we're talking about Lovecraftian movies, do you have, in your opinion, what are some good examples, if any, in your opinion, of movies that do Lovecraft right or do cosmic horror right?
Well, those are two different questions.
Yeah.
There are precious few movies that do Lovecraft right. We talked about Reanimator, which actually does Reanimator right, because Reanimator is a ridiculous story that Lovecraft knew was a ridiculous story while he was writing it. And, you know, Reanimator does it ridiculously in exactly the same sort of lurid, nonsensical way that Lovecraft did. So in a way, that is the truest to Lovecraft's vision film yet, because his vision was, mercenary and transient when he wrote Reanimator. In terms of the stuff that is, sort of done, what we might think of as the great stories, the real stuff, well, that's a much shorter list. I think that you can look at things like some of the HPL Historical Society stuff. Obviously, their Silent Call of Cthulhu is pretty terrific. I very much enjoyed Whisper in Darkness. I thought that parts of it got to where Lovecraft was with Whisper, which is again pretty great. I think that the Tony Gildark film Cthulhu, which I don't know if you've seen or not, the with Tori Spelling shows up in it two-thirds of the way through, where the guy's return to Innsmouth becomes a metaphor for his coming out to his family as gay, which is not at all the way I would have gone with that story. But the actual film is really, surprisingly good. Once you've, when you read what was available about it before you see it, it's like Tori Spelling, and it's a, gay coming-of-age narrative. And I'm like, there is no way this is going to be good. And it's actually really terrific. And it turns out because they didn't have the budget to shoot the monster sequence twice, so they couldn't shoot. They couldn't use what they shot, so they had to work around it, which made the story a million times better. Because instead of seeing whatever horrible cheap monster they had, all they can do is allude to it and mention it in flashbacks.
Kind of like the Jaws problem.
Exactly, and a lot of the side bits and the pieces that he put into it. I think that's actually a surprisingly good version of Shadow. In terms of what cosmic horror is good, obviously you have a bigger, field to play on. You can look at things like Alien, which is one of the most Lovecraftian films ever made, with both the sort of visceral body horror that Lovecraft indulges in and also the larger scope of, ancient dead aliens that we don't know about. I think that you can look at individual pieces of other movies also, but there's things like Forbidden Voyage, I think it is, the mockumentary about going to Antarctica. No one exactly knows what's going on there.
That doesn't ring a bell.
I'll
have to check.
Give me 2 seconds and I'll find
out. Yeah, no problem. While you're looking that up, I have to really strongly agree with you about the Cthulhu movie. From the very beginning of that film, there's this feeling of doom. I think the movie's done very, very well.
It's sort of a modern Val Lewton film, in that you don't really see the monsters.
Yeah. I mean, that's one of the things that I liked about it, was that it's got that human component to it, because the guy's story is so compelling and interesting.
The ending of that, where they're driving along the highway and all the people are running down to the beach, and you just see the beach littered with cultists.
Yeah,
and they're running towards something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just terrific. I mean, in terms of great cosmic horror moments, there's the moment in the original Godzilla where Godzilla's footprint has a smashed trilobite in it, and that suddenly takes something from sort of a modern day monster movie and blows it way out. It has a great cosmic horror frisson in that, or in the original The Thing, where they are backing out slowly over the ice, and the camera keeps pulling back, and you see how big the flying saucer is that they've found, and that they have found a flying saucer. That's a movement, a moment in terms of cosmic horror that not even Carpenter's film, which obviously is a million times better, doesn't ever get back to, because Carpenter is so much more interested in the personal horror and the body horror stuff.
I thought the scariest moment in the thing was the conclusion was the reporter.
Yeah.
Watch the skies.
Mm-hmm. The movie I was talking about was Forbidden Quest. It's a fake documentary about an Antarctic voyage, and I shouldn't mention any more about it, but that's a really great cosmic horror, horror of unknowingness.
What year?
1993,
you said?
Yeah, I think John Tynes may have turned me onto that. That's about the same era that John Tynes was turning me onto stuff.
All right, I'll definitely check that out.
Yeah.
Well, you mentioned it. What did you think of Prometheus? Just
I like the visuals well enough. It was great. It was the same Ridley visuals that I enjoyed. I liked parts of it a good deal, as the curate said of the egg, I guess. But you know, overall, it's not a worthy part of the franchise, and it's certainly not a worthy successor to Alien or predecessor to Alien. In any way that matters. I think if Ridley Scott had just said, this is a film I'm making, and it's going to, and had never mentioned Alien, and we'd all seen it, it would still be stupid, but it would not seem as blasphemous, I guess, as it did.
Did you feel it resemble At the Mountains of Madness too much?
Well, first of all, there's no such thing as resembling At the Mountains of Madness too much. But but second of all, you know, If anything, it resembled the Robert Block homage to At the Mountains of Madness that he wrote for Star Trek, where they go to the planet where Ted Cassidy plays the robot left over from ancient times, and they don't know what to do with Ted Cassidy, and they're building robot duplicates of everybody.
The old ones.
If it matched anything, it matched that more than it matched actual Mountains of Madness. I mean, I certainly, I would be interested to see what Guillermo del Toro thinks he wants to do with The Mountains of Madness. Given his spotty track record at making films that I approve of, I'm not sure that I'm eager for him to do it, but I'd be interested to see what he does.
Yeah, I kind of feel like he's not quite the filmmaker everyone thinks he is, too.
Kronos was great, but every one of his movies since then has had one or another really jarring flaw for me. And this may just be a personal thing. But I'm outside the consensus on Guillermo as well. Although he loves Lovecraft and he loves us, so I shouldn't be mean.
No, I personally liked his movies like The Devil's Backbone.
Yeah, that's
The Devil's
good.
Backbone was 20 minutes of perfection in 2 hours of padding, and the trouble is the 20 minutes came in the first half of the movie.
Yeah.
So the last half of the movie is literally you coming down from the ghost story, which was perfect, literally perfect.
Right.
But that's like saying Into the Blue is a great movie because it has 9 minutes of Jessica Alba swimming. That does not actually mean the rest of the movie.
You might get away if the best part is in the last half hour.
Right.
Mike and I were talking about Godzilla before, and that was sort of feeling.
Yeah. What was that movie he did a couple of years ago with the goblins or whatever the hell they were?
Labyrinth. Yeah.
Sorry, what was it?
Pan's Labyrinth.
No, not that one. It was after that.
You don't mean the Hellboy movies?
Hellboy 2.
No. No, the one with the house.
Yeah.
Oh, the people under the stands, or
no?
But I was very disappointed by it. Is all I'm trying to say, really. The name escapes me at the moment.
It's a remake of a Goosebumps episode or something like that.
Are you serious?
I saw it was a remake of a TV movie with Kim Darby.
Yeah. Something like that.
Oh, right, yeah. I may have not even seen that. That was, the warning sign, the warning flags were up front instead of during the movie itself, which I appreciated, I guess.
Yeah. Well, kind of the same question on cosmic horror, but what are some of your favorite short stories or novels that you think do that really well?
I think in my experience, I am really, really fond of Thomas Ligotti, and obviously I'm pretty sure I'm not alone, even on this actual chat, much less in the universe, unlike, of course, the Thomas Ligotti protagonist.
Don't be afraid to start, someone posted, yes. Okay.
But yeah, Ligotti is amazing. I mean, he is, as far as I'm concerned, the only legitimate you know, claimant to the throne. But certainly you can look at people like Laird Barron, who does a terrific job of presenting both cosmic horror and human, you know, I don't want to say tragedy, but human collapse or human failure in a really, in what's not just a Lovecraftian way. I mean, people who do Lovecraft can do Lovecraft, and, you know, they're as great as an Impressionist or an Elvis impersonator ever is. But, you know, I like someone who takes their own voice and does it well. And I think that Laird Barron is probably another, you know, contender for really good cosmic horror. You can look at, you know, stuff like Greg Egan's science fiction that's got a lot of cosmic horror in it. Once you sort of, you know, edit out the part that he has to put in to, you know, keep the book turning, that, you know, the backdrops and the sort of the things that he drops in and on the sides, there's a lot of good stuff in that. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to think if there's anyone else recently that I would touch on for that. There's a Caitlin Kiernan's, one of her earliest novels, Threshold, is really good for that. It's like Algernon Blackwood, Deep Time with paleontology tied in, which I always appreciate, much as Lovecraft did. So I would recommend Threshold by Kiernan as a terrific piece of cosmic horror. And again, one that isn't just trying to go back and drink out of Lovecraft's well, that's trying to sink her own well, or at least drink out of Blackwood's well, which is, you know...
Yeah. Totally agree. That's a great novel. That's a very, very good novel. If you guys have questions for Ken, please jump in. I don't want to hog the panel here. What are you working on right now, Ken? You mentioned before the show that you're keeping really busy.
Yeah, right now I'm finishing up the Serpent People issue of Ken Writes About Stuff. Every other issue is a different Lovecraftian or Cthulhoid monster that I take and expand on and present a lot of different ways to understand it. Because the thing, Lovecraft wrote his monsters because he was worried that vampires and werewolves and ghosts were all too familiar, right? That no one was genuinely scared by them. They were scared by seeing the sign and saying, oh, it's a vampire, I guess I have to be scared. And Lovecraft invented deep ones and ghouls and all the other, and great race of Yith and stuff like that, precisely because the old monsters were sort of played out. Well, now, after 40 years of play in Call of Cthulhu, we tend to have the same reaction to deep ones or ghouls or some of the sort of standards. So the goal with Hideous Creatures is to take those monsters, re-explore them, open them up, present a bunch of different possibilities, different powers and abilities that they might have in your game, ways that they might present themselves to the players that they haven't seen a million times before, different meanings, different interpretations, and get it back to the unknowable, you know, single truth in a horde of misleading facts that Lovecraft's fiction tries to present and tries to build in everything. And so right now I'm doing the Serpent People, one of that, which is basically taking, which is, as it turns out, Robert E. Howard's Serpent People mostly, and trying to give a bunch of different ways to look at them. Legends of serpent-bodied demons and fairies, and could they have been the Serpent People, and that kind of thing. Or in Robert E. Howard's version, unlike the Chaosium version, the Serpent People don't have to eat you to take your shape. So what does that do? Just presenting that creates a whole different, you know, dynamic in terms of story.
Well, before you continue talking about what you're working on right now, talk just a little bit about Ken Writes About Stuff. I mean, how can people subscribe to it? Is it print? What exactly is it?
It's a PDF only, sort of, I guess, periodical, you want to call it, or long-form series of essays. But it comes out every month from Pelgrain Press, and you can either buy the individual issues on the Pelgrain Press web store or from drivethroughrpg.com, which is the biggest role-playing game retailer. You can buy it on e23.com, which is Steve Jackson Games' retailer, although I think that may be warehouse23.com now. Or you can subscribe, and if you subscribe, you get the whole year at, you know, I think it's 30% off the newsstand price. And every other month is a Lovecraftian creature examined and built out, like I just mentioned, and in the interim, it might be just whatever I feel like writing about. So I've looked at the city of Mumbai as a role-playing location. I've done a campaign frame in which you're investigating UFOs, sort of a mini gumshoe game where you're investigating UFO crashes in 1978. I've done a sort of in-depth examination of the urban legend, if you want to call it that, of Die Glocke, the Nazi bell experiment that they supposedly built in a salt mine in Silesia in the 1940s that may have been a time machine or a UFO engine or a UFO time machine. That sort of thing. Just whatever I'm into. And then I write about it. And if you go on the Pelgrane Press site and you search on Ken Writes About Stuff or KWAS, you can find the list
for everybody watching. Jeremy and I just at the same time posted a link to the subscription page, I believe it is, on the Lovecraft message board. So I think that's an easy way, if I understand it, to get individual issues or to subscribe. So
yeah, certainly, you know, with a little Google foo and goodwill, you can find the individual issues. And if you subscribe, then you don't even worry about that. They'll just show up in your mailbox, or rather the download code will show up in your mailbox.
Yeah.
And they're between, you know, 4,000 and 8,000 words, you know, a month. It's not, you know, you'll have plenty of time to read it, certainly. And you can drop it into any game you're playing, ideally a gumshoe game, because that's, you know, what the publisher would like. But, you know, if you're playing Call of Cthulhu, the Cthulhu monsters will translate transparently to Call of Cthulhu, and you won't have any problem, you know, using the sort of notions and scenario seeds and whatever.
Okay. What else are you working on right now?
I'm working on an adventure long-form campaign for Knights Black Agents, which is another game that I did for Pelgrane, which is Spies versus Vampires. The sort of elevator pitch for that is Jason Bourne versus Dracula. Or if in the Bourne trilogy, it's the Bourne trilogy if Treadstone were vampires. So you play spies who are, you know, discover that there's a giant conspiracy of vampires out there. You're burned spies. And, of course, being decent people, you hunt them down and destroy them. This is the Dracula dossier, which posits that the Bram Stoker's novel Dracula is part of the cover-up of a MI6 program, although it predates MI6 per se, to recruit a vampire as an asset. And they tried that in 1897, and it, you know, came to a catastrophic end, as indicated by the novel. And then they kept trying to wake him up when they thought that it was more important. So in 1940, they try to recruit Dracula to keep the Nazis out of Romania. In the 70s, there's a mole hunt for Dracula's stay-behind network in England. That someone wakes up Dracula during that. And then during the, you know, in the last couple of years, someone said, hey, Dracula hated Muslims. This could work out really well. And they woke him up as a deniable anti-terror operative. And, of course, that, as one might have predicted, also has gone terribly. But the player characters get a copy of the first draft of Dracula before Stoker was made to take out all the sources and methods by the Home Office. And using the annotated version of that novel, they then hunt down Dracula in modern-day Europe or Romania or Turkey or wherever it is that he's, you know, hiding out, and they take him down in hopes once and for all. And that's the larger structure of the campaign, and the sort of the spin on it is that it's an improvised campaign in that there's no one solution. Wherever the players follow the clues is where the clues already led. So the source book gives you all the stuff to put in, and as the director or the GM, your job is to just stay that one leap ahead of the players and keep laying down track as they drive towards the final confrontation with Dracula.
Awesome.
So you, that is a job of work, because I also have to rewrite Dracula, but
that's a lot of work.
Well, a lot of people have been rewriting Dracula recently.
Yeah, but at least I'm going to leave Bram Stoker's name on it, so.
Yeah. I think Penny Dreadful is doing that currently.
Oh, God. Just move on. John. Okay. Fortunately, when they advertised that in the movie theater, they had John Logan up there to talk about it. It's like, well, that saved me time. Thanks, movie theater. Part of that.
Go ahead, Ken.
My kids love these books.
Oh, great.
Yeah, I was about to ask about these. Good.
My kids are 4 and 5,
mm-hmm.
and we read these about once a week.
Fantastic.
And
we've got the third one?
I do not have the third one.
Okay. It's Clifford the Big Red God.
Yes. Right.
It takes Clifford the Big Red Dog and adds a U to him to make him parody, and therefore not a lawsuit. And it also sets it as the Dunwich Horror retold as a heartwarming children's tale.
Yes. My kids they love this one, but they adore this one.
Oh, fantastic. That's great. I'm really glad. I don't think that Christina Rodriguez gets enough credit for the incredible job that she did on the art of Antarctic Express. It's just
stunning.
I mean, really Stephen Ellsberg is tougher to parody, I think, and she just does an amazing job in that. Yeah. I mean, Andy Hopp obviously is terrific in Where the Deep Ones Are and in Clifford, but, you know, Antarctic Express, I see the royalty statements. It doesn't get the love, so I'm glad you liked it, and I'm even gladder that your kids like it.
And absolutely. As a matter of fact, that's actually the question I was going to ask before Pete asked this was, what inspired you to write these Lovecraftian children's books?
That was a drunken conversation. myself and the publisher, John Nephew, and a friend and fellow designer and publisher of ours, James Wallace, were all sitting around a table, and we were talking about Lovecraft and, you know, ways to do it, and this predated the, you know, Jane Austen with zombies thing. But we were saying, you know what there ought to be? There ought to be a thing where Alice goes through the looking glass and winds up in hyperspace and meets Brown Jenkins. That would be awesome. And so we're saying, yeah, but then you have to draw it. The illustrations all have to be John Tenniel illustrations, and that would be tough. And we're just sort of riffing on that, and that turned into about 8 million different beloved children's stories made Lovecraftian. And once everyone had sobered up, or perhaps not, John Nephew, the publisher, said, you know, we were talking about that Maurice Sendak idea that we all had. Maybe you should write that for us. I said, well, all right. And I wrote it, and it turned out to be really successful. And John said, what's the next one you're going to write? And that's basically how it's worked, is I've written one of those every 2 or 3 years for John, and the series keeps on plugging.
So the moral here is that drinking is good for you.
Yes, drinking is good for creativity. listen to Papa Hemingway, people. Don't listen to modern writers' programs. It's all about the bourbon.
Somebody should write a book on how all the great ideas that came to writers in bars.
Mm-hmm. Well, Thomas De Quincey did it for opium, so the next step is there.
I had a viewer wrote in ahead of time and wanted me to ask you, I don't know why 3 is the magical number, but he wanted me to ask you, what are your 3 favorite stories by Lovecraft? So I'm passing on that question.
You're passing on that question. I would say that my 3 favorite are The Color Out of Space, which is also the absolute best one of Lovecraft stories. And then I would personally say that my next 2 favorite stories of his are Charles Dexter Ward, which is just amazingly good, but is also, because it's got that antiquarian and architectural sensibility so deeply built into it, Lovecraft and I think, you know, I have that in common with him. I have that same admiration for architecture and for antiquarianism and the past and like that. So I really, that one really, really works for me. And then as far as what my 3rd favorite is, it's probably whichever one of them I read most recently, but I think Haunter of the Dark may actually be my 3rd, even though it's, I think, substantively weaker story than a lot of the other ones. But I like it because it is so clearly a work of Lovecraft's love for Robert Bloch and his friendship with Bloch, and he wrote that basically both as an extended practical joke and as a real honest-to-God story. And it really works as a horror piece. It's a beautiful addition to the mythos. It's his last story, and you have a sort of elegiac quality to it in the same way that you can get that when you read The Tempest and you compare it to other Shakespeare's. This is the one where he knows that he's going out, mm-hmm. and he's done with it. And also, it's just a nice story to see, a Lovecraft story in which the Poles and the Italians are the people who are trying to fix things. Right, the filthy Mediterranean races are actually the good guys in it. I mean, that's, you know, I'm not one of those people who believes, oh no, Lovecraft stopped being racist when it became convenient for my political beliefs. But I just like the fact that in Haunter of the Dark, you know, he's sort of refuting literarily, if not politically, the Horror at Red Hook and some of the other stuff that's more problematic for a Lovecraft fan. So I like that aspect of it. But I also, I like the tone. I like the tenor. I like the sort of dreaminess to it. If he'd written his Dreamland stories in that voice, they would be a million times better, I think. And it's just kind of a shame that he was done with the Dreamlands and then sadly dead before he could go back and maybe write House of the Worm in that same tenor, because that would have been magnificent.
That's a very interesting point about refuting a little bit somewhat the horror Red Hook with that last story.
Yeah, I mean, it's possible to over-argue it and over-read it, but I do think that if you look at it right there, you know, it's even past Witch House, which I love, but in which the crucifix is actually does nothing, and the prayers of his Polish roommate are just sort of an annoying drone. They're not contributing anything. They're actually adding to the horror. And then if you just move just a few years past that, the Poles and the Italians are putting up a light barrier, which we know from the story is the only thing that has a chance of working against the Haunter. And so it's just that's a nice touch, and I'm glad that Lovecraft, you know, agreed that even though his beloved Federal Hill was full of filthy Catholics, that they could be counted on, you know, when the chips were down.
Yeah. Well, you know, speaking of that aspect of Lovecraft, and I know you were on a panel. You and I were both at the film festival, as was Pete. But I didn't get to sit in on your panel that you were on. I think I pulled up the History and Lovecraft, the Eugenics Climate and Turn of the Century USA. Was that the name of that panel?
Yeah, that was the name of it. Sylvia Moreno-Garcia put that together. And I think she intended, and I had hoped that we would have gotten to do a panel more specifically about eugenics and less about, you know, Lovecraft's personal racism, because eugenics is a bigger topic than Lovecraft and a bigger topic than a lot of the sort of, you know, ritual condemnations of Lovecraft are. But as these things, I suspect, always do, it sort of, you know, veered off to the side and became, you know, how do we as nice people allow ourselves to read Lovecraft, which, again, you know, I don't want to criticize anyone, but try reading something written a century in which you didn't live and see how that works for you.
Same reason why we can appreciate the Declaration of Independence written by Thomas Jefferson, I suppose.
Yeah, well, the Declaration also has sort of a continuing pragmatic effect, but we can appreciate, you know, stuff written by William Shakespeare, who I promise you believed all kinds of stuff that would get him thrown out of any decent liberal arts college.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about the eugenics part a little bit, since you didn't get to there, or no?
I mean, I don't want to step on Sylvia's toes there, but, I mean, eugenics is part and parcel of Lovecraft's, not his sort of social opinions, it's part and parcel of his scientific, advanced, progressive thought, right? At that time, at the time he was writing, you know, the racial basis or the genetic basis of race was uncontroversial. You know, Boaz, you know, in the turn of the century, in the 1900s and teens, is beginning to demonstrate that the skull measurements, which a lot of that racial theory was based on, were more fluid and more plastic than people thought, that your skull changed shape basically as child nutrition. But the fundamental question of are races genetically different and are therefore some races maybe farther along the evolutionary ladder than other races, that was, you know, that was in the textbook that Scopes was trying to teach in Tennessee, right? That was the evolution textbook that Scopes was using, was all about the evolution of different races as well. So when William Jennings Bryan is up there saying, we're not going to be teaching, you know, evolution, we laugh at him now, but he's also saying we're not going to be teaching eugenics, which is something that maybe we would agree with now, I would hope. And so when we look at Lovecraft and his love of cutting-edge science, he talks about relativity, he talks about Antarctic exploration, he talks about astronomy, all these other aspects, that his eugenic beliefs are part of that, not necessarily part of his, you know, being an old fuddy-duddy who still pledged allegiance to King George III.
Mm-hmm.
Or at the very least, they're not in conflict. And I think that that's sort of an aspect of Lovecraft's eugenics belief that is underemphasized, is the degree to which that was absolutely progressive. And as his politics changed from being a pre-democratic and pre-capitalist aristocrat to being a post-democratic and post-capitalist fascist, I'm not sure that he was not going to let go of eugenics at any point in that transition.
You know, it's funny, and I'm probably going to get in trouble for this, but a lot of people point to The Shadow over Innsmouth and say he's talking about miscegenation, race breeding, and the production of this horrific crossbreeding that is just horrific and terrifying and subhuman and inhuman.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard those arguments, and then I get to the end of the story where the narrator embraces everything, becomes one, and acknowledges that these are his people and that they are a superior species, and that he will go down and he will dwell in wonder and glory forever. And I have to sit there and wonder, what happened? I mean, you can read anything and take out any little bit you want, but when you read this story as a whole, maybe it is about race, but if it is, then it's about embracing it.
Well, it is if you believe that Lovecraft didn't think the ending was horrific.
I don't think it is.
I'm fairly sure Lovecraft thought he was writing a horror story. Now, that may be controversial in these modern days, but yeah. I'm pretty sure that Lovecraft intended the end of Shadow over Innsmouth to be akin to the end of Honor in the Dark, where the guy says, you know, Yog-Sothoth, the three-lobed eye, you know, Yog-Sothoth, Neblod, Zin, we are one,
right,
and is subsumed into the Haunter.
Right.
No one sits there and says, oh, good, he's embraced the Haunter, good. Now the three-eyed among us can all love Lovecraft as I do. I'm pretty sure that Lovecraft sees the end of Shadow as a pretty unequivocally horrific ending, although because he is a great writer and because Olmsted is a deeper character than most Lovecraft characters, there is a dimensionality to it that allows modern people to read that. I mean, I was just dramaturg for a play, an adaptation of The Shadow over Innsmouth in Chicago by the Wildclaw Theater here, and their ending of the show is similarly nuanced, right? Multivariant. You can either see it as, oh, she's been kidnapped by fish people, that's terrible, or you can see it as, she's found herself, she's with her people, that's such a nice ending,
right?
You can read it both ways. But in the same way that William Shakespeare is not writing Shylock as anything except a hilarious Dean Wormer villain, the fact that we are now reading into Shylock a plea for understanding of all religions is our bringing something to Shakespeare, not Shakespeare bringing something to us. But that, one could argue, is what literature is, right? Mm-hmm. Homer is not writing the Iliad for, doughy Democrats in the future. He's writing the Iliad for guys who will stab him if the story isn't good.
Yeah, right.
And so when we bring our own, beliefs about war and gods and peace to the Iliad, that's why you can tell the Iliad is literature, because it still responds. And our beliefs about, otherness have changed since 1930, and so therefore our beliefs about our response to The Shadow over Innsmouth is more nuanced and differently colored than Lovecraft's was, or even than Lovecraft's intended audiences was, possibly.
Which is why it works as a race story or a coming out story.
Right, or just as a plain old horror story. It all depends on what you emphasize. And again, you can say the same thing about all great literature. Is you can take, the Tempest is read as an anti-colonial narrative, even though there's probably not a chance that Shakespeare thought it was an anti-colonial narrative. He thought he was doing the old people are trapped on a desert island and hilarity ensues story. But we now read it as an anti-colonial narrative, and it still works that way, because that's how literature works. Mm-hmm. If you created a great piece of literature, you don't have to pack all those meanings into it, but the fact that they can be unpacked from it is what makes it live, as opposed to, pointless. You don't go back to a place called Dagon, one of the terrible short novels that he based that on, and say, oh, wow, that's a really meaningful piece of work. It now speaks to me because we have a greater understanding of horrible fish cultists. No, we don't really. It's just a terrible novel. But Shadow is much better.
Yeah.
Sort of a bad idea. Well, you have a lot of novels which are bad ideas, which the better writer then makes a good idea.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, there's no shortage of that. And there are people who have even taken individual bits of Lovecraft or pre-1926 bits of Lovecraft and have turned them into much better works. Although no one has ever taken, his real absolute top-notch stuff and improved it, I think.
Well, Ken, I cannot tell you how much I've enjoyed listening to you expound on all this and enjoyed talking with you. I really appreciate you being on the show.
Well, I'm happy to do it, man, anytime.
Yeah, well, I was going to say, I hope that you'll come back sometime soon because I really enjoyed talking with you. Talking to the audience now, be sure to go on Amazon or to Google Ken and pick up some of his books. If you got kids, pick up those children's books. I know I'm going to be buying, I've got it right in front of me right now, Tour de Lovecraft later on today because that looks extremely, extremely interesting. We talked about that earlier. So.
Yeah.
And Shadows Over Finland. Filmland.
Yeah, Shadows Over Finland may be an entirely different work, but Shadows Over Filmland is our compilation of, it's a Adventures for Trail of Cthulhu, so it'll work on that level. They can be ported to Call of Cthulhu without too much work, and if you're a real film buff, you can probably read them as just enjoyable closet drama without ever rolling a die. So,
well, yeah, I'm pretty sure Rick's gonna be buying that one.
Great. Well, we'll have Rick min-maxing his character in no time.
So anyway, thanks a lot for being here, Ken. We're gonna talk to Jeremy about his upcoming anthology here, so you can stay or go, whatever you want to do. But I really think I get on the show. So
I think I heard my wife come home, so I'd probably better go see if I need to be providing dinner at some point. But thanks very much, guys.
Thanks. Appreciate
it. Having you.
Wait.
Talk to you soon.
So, Mike.
Yeah.
Is this Jeremy Holler?
It is?
Okay, because I've never met the guy in person.
Hi.
But I'm going to say this. When we started this conversation tonight, we needed $900.
Where are we at now?
We need $149.
Oh, wow. You're going to make it, Jeremy, buddy.
And we were running. Yesterday I looked at it and I said we need to make about $100 an hour. And I was looking at it and I was like, it's doable, but I've never seen it done before. And right around the $900 mark, about at the 9 hour mark, we started churning in more than $100 an hour. And we're now down to 6 hours to go, and we need $150.
That's awesome. So, Jeremy, you want to tell the audience, talk a little bit about this anthology that you're wanting to do, and looks like you are going to be able to do now.
Let's hope so. Yeah. So, I've been trying to explain it to people that don't really read Lovecraft or aren't really in that circle, I guess. And so we're trying to explain it. It's kind of, you know, cosmic horror meets fairy tales.
that does sum it up.
Yeah, and it's each story is supposed to have a theme that pulls from, you know, a fairy tale and either a Lovecraft story or a mythos story. It didn't have to be Lovecraftian. Like, it could be, you know, King in Yellow. It's been used throughout the mythos, but it was Chambers originally. But you know, Joe Pulver he's in there and he's writing stuff on it. And there was a submitted story that uses a little bit of King in Yellow and stuff like that. So we're being pretty open with it. Yeah.
What, you know, this is your first book, right?
It is.
What inspired you to want to do this? This is a great idea.
For lack of a better reason, it's something I've been wanting to read, and no one has done it. So I actually started a publishing company going on 15 years ago, and we got out of it because it just wasn't – there were three of us that were involved, and we were all doing separate things, and it just wasn't working out. And so we came back together end of last year, and we had been doing RPG stuff, and I was thinking about it. I'm like, I really want to read this book that I've had in my mind for a while, but no one. There's a couple people out there that have published, you know, one or two short stories that are kind of along this line, but it's not like an actual full on book. And so I just
you just described exactly why I'm doing an upcoming anthology called Autumn Cthulhu, because I wanted to read stories like that.
Right. You know? Right. I think it's the best reason.
Yeah. Yeah, and I've gotten some good ones so far.
When does that due out?
What's that?
When is that due out?
The goal is to have it out right before Necronomicon next year. So August 2015, maybe July 2015, somewhere around in there. So, but a Mythos Grimly. Have you accepted any stories yet, or just looking them over?
So we did two things with this. Because we didn't know what kind of interest we were going to get with it, and obviously it's our first book, and we sent out a lot of invitations to people that we have read, that we like their style, we liked what they do. So we kind of figured they were going to end up creating something that we would feel comfortable publishing. But that being said, we didn't know how many of those people were going to get on board with us being a first-time publisher with a book like this. Mm. And so we also sent out an invitation for just kind of an open call, and we ended up getting, I think there were 40-some submissions, which was a little less than we expected, but it was still a lot to read through. And so we ended up kind of culling through those and decided what we wanted to use. And so, yeah, if the Kickstarter does succeed, which it looks like it will, then we do have submissions that have been accepted, and then we have the invited authors, which are kind of pre-accepted unless there's just some kind of meltdown in between. I don't know.
yeah, it's kind of neat. Laird Barron's writing a story for Autumn Cthulhu, and I can't imagine not accepting it, but, you know.
Yeah, right.
And
it works both ways, Mike, because, you know, because I've never worked with Jeremy. He doesn't know the creative process that I go through. So I actually sent him the first draft, and I'm like, please, 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 you know, let this be what he wanted.
Yeah, with this, you know, we had a certain amount of money that we already had to invest in it, but we needed at least some of the Kickstarter to work, and because Kickstarter it's all or nothing. You don't get the chance to, you know, say, oh, well, we only made this much, like Indiegogo or whatever, but we didn't want to roll the dice and say, you know, if we don't make it, what do we do? So we did Kickstarter, and I said, don't write anything yet, you know, and I was like, if it fails, I'd feel really terrible, and then, you know, Peter sent me his thing, and I've got one from William Michael and everything, and I'm like, oh no, what if it fails? And so
yeah, because you but, asked me to submit something too, and I don't even have the idea to you yet because, you know, I wanted to make sure the Kickstarter went, which it looks like it's going to.
Yeah,
You probably, like me, you probably wait to make a lot of decisions until you know it's going to happen. But with that said, do you know how many stories you want to have in this anthology?
You know, we were aiming for at least 20 because I feel like, you know, anything less for this size of book, because we kind of wanted to go for at least a 500-page book, and we were aiming for between 3,000 and 7,000 words per story. So, you know, just doing all the math and everything, if everything worked out right, we were going for between 20 and 25 stories.
That's a big book. That's great.
Yeah, it looks like we're going to end up with, I think we actually have 27 that will be in the book itself.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, Pete's been talking to me about it for a while, so.
Yeah, I know I don't want to spoil it, but
yeah.
the Mandy and I sat down and we wrote this story. And when we finished and she read the final version and I read the final version, she looked at me and said, "You've got some balls."
Okay.
I didn't want to give it away, and the other day I was trying to, you know, this is it, the description of the book is kind of generic because we don't, you know, not all the stories have been written, and so we didn't want to, you know, say this is what's going to be in the book, but I was trying to explain what Pete's story was without giving it away, and that was kind of hard, so. I think I did it. I didn't give away your secret, but it's a good secret.
It's a huge secret. And if you've read any Hannes Bach, then you might have an inkling of what I'm doing. If you there's a Babylon 5 tie-in.
Well, Jeremy, I'm confused because you Didn't you? I thought you told me privately that you had rejected Pizza Cake.
Oh, see, that was the secret.
Yeah, this is
actually added a tier to pay for him to not be in the book.
Oh, okay.
And now you have a Babylon 5 tie-in. You've ruined it for me right now.
No, Pete is an extremely good writer. As a matter of fact, I believe he's one of two that I've so far accepted for Autumn Cthulhu. Nice. Wrote a very, very, very good story for that. So yeah, I have no doubt that his story in Mythos Grimly is great.
Well, there's so much I want to say, Jeremy.
For his wife. His wife is the writer, and they put his name on it, so.
I don't know if you guys saw my post on my Facebook page. We sat down for family movie night. We watched the new version of The Secret Life of Walter Mitty.
Oh, and, yeah. I told Danielle that might be a good movie for us to watch together.
Yeah, it's really good.
Okay.
But my 4-year-old, at the end of the movie, starts going over plot, clue points, and foreshadowing, and I'm sitting there arguing with her, and she's saying, no, Daddy, that meant this, and this meant that, and I'm like, I'm arguing with a 4-year-old over the use of foreshadowing and literary themes, and I'm losing.
Well, you're doing something right, though.
So, you know, yeah.
I Joe and Logan told me, hey, they broke the fourth wall when they did that. I was so proud.
Yeah. I thought it was a really good movie, and I highly recommend it, even as a family movie. There's like one mention of sex, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
But the rest of it is all really family friendly.
Jeremy, you're at 99.26, buddy.
$74 to go. Left to go.
When we started talking a few minutes ago, now you've gotten halfway through that goal.
Awesome.
So thank you to everybody watching and
pleasure.
Absolutely.
Appreciate it. Sorry, Pete, what were we gonna say?
Well, you know, when we sat down, when Manny and I sat down to think about what we wanted to do, and Jeremy didn't give us any real direction. He just said fairy tales in the Cthulhu mythos, you know, it's like here's some salt and here's some flour. Figure out what you can do with it, you know.
I'm sorry to interrupt real quick, but I don't know if you want to be more constrictive than that with something like this, because there's so many good ideas out there.
Right. Though.
Well, you know, we said, do you want to tell a fairy tale that is then take a regular fairy tale and add some mythos elements to it? So it's not Little Red Riding Hood meets the Big Bad Wolf, it's the Big Bad Shoggoth, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so we could have done that. Or could you have taken a fairy tale told from the point of view of some mythos species? You know, the Mother Hydra's nursery rhymes. You know, exists as a book, by the way, which I think is an absolutely fabulous book. But, yeah, could you do Deep One or Ghoul fairy tales? And then the third thing that we came up with was just to tell a straight mythos story, but then retell a fairy tale within it, and or have the fairy tale be important to the story. And you see authors like Stephen King and other writers do this, where they take a fairy tale and they embed it in the work, and it becomes this horrible little turning point.
Laird Barron and
And Laird Barron does it too. And we early on stuck that goal, and we figured out something we wanted to do. And yeah, we did something big. And we're really excited about it. And I want it to be in this book.
Yeah, I could tell that you were very excited about this. You've mentioned it to me privately several times.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, you know, you're really the person that put it on my radar, even before Jeremy did. And you know, Jeremy, honestly, I'm not trying to butter you up or anything, but honestly, I think it's a really good original idea. There's a lot of Lovecraftian anthologies out there these days, and there's some of them are very, very good, and some of them aren't so original. You know, they're just kind of there, you know. And I think this is going to be really good. It's a really great idea.
Yeah, we're definitely hoping. And that's part of the reason, going back to me not giving direction. We didn't know if that was going to be a hindrance to anyone, and I think it actually ended up being a plus for everything, because there are so many authors that are taking this in completely different directions that I didn't even think of, and it's being multicultural, so it's not just Grimm. It's, you know, there's Irish stuff, there's Hispanic stuff, there's Asian stuff going on, and it's, you know, I feel like if we would have said this is what you have to do, that wouldn't have flown. The flow of it would have been lost. So I thought it was really.
Yeah, I mean, I agree as an editor too. I mean, you don't want to micromanage, really. You know,
right.
You got the talented people creating stuff for you. I got artists that create stuff for the stories, and then, you know, I got authors that submit stuff, and I, you know, you don't want to box them in.
Totally.
Do you want to? If you don't want to, that's fine. But do you want to talk about who else you invited? That's probably gonna.
Yeah, I can kind of give a rundown here. So Joe Pulver was invited. Peter and Manny. I'm sorry. Who? Was that
Pulver? What? Who's that?
He's some guy. I think he's got a book or two out there.
Okay. Sorry, go ahead.
Jean-Claude Smith.
Good writer.
Robert Price. And then we actually kind of did a little overtime trying to find some women authors, just because we felt they were kind of being underrepresented in the anthology. And so we found some really great people, Mary San Giovanni, Sylvia Moreno Garcia, that we contacted, and they got on board, and so that's really awesome. I've been talking with them about their stories and really excited to read those. William Michael, Tracy McBride, Brett Talley.
Mm-hmm.
Gonzalez?
What's that?
Gonzalez.
Yeah, JF Gonzalez.
I love his work.
And it's funny, I actually have books of his that I owned that I didn't realize that I owned. Always a plus.
Is that Clickers?
Yeah.
What's Clickers?
Clickers is a. There's three books in the series now, I think.
Yeah.
I
think they're working on a fourth.
Clickers is essentially giant crabs come out of the ocean and start rampaging on the coasts of the United States, eating whole cities.
Oh, I hate when that happens.
And it's, you know, it's a pretty much, you know, straight giant crab monster story until you realize that the crabs are being driven out of the ocean by something worse.
Oh, wow, that's great.
They're just the first wave. Huh. And it's very Lovecraftian series.
So who else you got, Jeremy, if you want to say?
Let's see. Michael Griffin's on there. He had some stuff in Joe Pulver, that one guy's.
Tom Lynch?
Puppets book.
You invited Tom? That's good.
Yeah.
That's right.
Desmond Reddick.
Sorry?
Desmond Reddick. He's a Canadian. I don't know if we should hold that against him or not.
Mm-hmm. You're Canadian. No, you're not. You're in Boulder. Close enough to Canada.
Let's see. Richard Garvin. Or sorry, Gavin.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I love his work. Yep.
Even when I'm typing it, I type his name wrong. I don't know why.
Nice guy and really good writer.
Nice. E. Catherine Toler, she actually does, she's been doing a lot of steampunk stuff, but her style kind of led me into it, and we contacted her, and she was really into it, so. And then we have some people, the people that submitted, I can name them too. I can try and name them because Nick Nafbliotis, I'm pretty sure that's how you say his name, and I probably butchered it, so sorry, Nick. Morgan Griffith, Jesse Carter, Christine Morgan.
Oh, I like Christine's stuff. I just got a story from her for my anthology.
Nice. I know she's in World War Cthulhu, which I think I won a copy and I bought a copy, so I'm looking forward to getting that and reading through it. Michael Hughes.
When do you think you'll have it published. What's yep. What are you shooting for?
We're aiming for December. If we can do it before December, it's even better, but we're kind of trying to be as conservative as possible. Yeah. And I guess it really depends on, one, how far the Kickstarter goes, because if we do end up launching into one of our stretch goals, which is to get it illustrated, and, that might slow us down a little bit, although it's like a $13,000 level, because yeah. The illustration is a little more expensive. If that ends up happening, that might slow us down. It's being done by Abigail Larson, and she did the Kickstarter exclusive cover, which I thought was pretty cool. Yeah,
about to ask, that's really, really good. Is she doing the cover for the book, too?
Yeah, so she's doing she did the cover for the book, and then if we reach that goal, then she'll do the interior stuff as well.
Okay.
Now, Jeremy, there's multiple, you're going to do an e-book.
Right.
You're going to do a paperback?
There's a paperback, and there's a hardcover.
Okay. Anything above that? Is there a signed hardcover?
So then yesterday we ended up adding on a limited, I mean, it's essentially you get the first 25 copies, or not one person gets them, but there's 25 of each one where they're going to be numbered, and it's the limited edition cover, so you get the limited edition cover, and it's, you know, the one of the first 25, and those are going to be author, or signed by their author of choice. So that's, it's still the hard, or it's still the Kickstarter cover, but it's not going to be, it's not necessarily a different one. You just kind of get some extra stuff with it.
Okay. I'm posting it on the Lovecraft eZine main page right now, so we can get that 75 chopped down.
Awesome. You're killing me, people. Absolutely. I will. If we make $10,000 in the next 5 minutes, I'll take my shirt off.
Or if we make more than that, you leave it on.
Well, you have so many fans out there that would love to see that, but I'm sure we're gonna. Let's see, Mythos Grimly, 2 M's, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
And
it took me a while to get used to spelling that way when I'm typing it.
The cool thing here, well, from my point of view, is that the story that I've got in this book coming out from Jeremy is very strongly tied into a chapter in The Weird Company.
Nice.
Oh, okay.
These are stories that I'm doing. Everybody seems to know my story. You know, I've done Hartwell, and I'm sneaking in stories about the Peasley family. Well, I'm also doing stories about Randolph Carter. But not the human Randolph Carter, the inhuman Randolph Carter. And there will be several appearing over the next few years.
Nice.
So, and this is the second one.
So Pete, I saw your you received your advanced reading copy of Weird Company. Is that the official cover?
Oh yeah, hold on.
Oh yeah.
I got it buried here someplace. All right. You see this?
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. So I posted this artwork on my webpage, on my Facebook page, and said, this is an important piece of art, and it is. It's the cover to my novel.
What's the
Martin?
What's the subtitle of the book?
The Secret History of H.P. Lovecraft's 20th Century. Hold it up there. So yeah, I'm busy rereading this, and I've come to hate my own work. Only because
it's so easy. That self-loathing thing.
You end up going crazy rereading it 20 times.
Yeah, and you're sitting there going, oh, God, did I really write that? And yeah, you really did.
And so you change it to make it better. Yeah. Or are you going to unwind the whole tapestry when you start to monkey around with it too much?
And yeah, and that can happen. Oh.
Echo, go.
Echo.
Who's writing? Are you writing the introduction to the book, or someone else? Do you know yet? Jeremy, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. The original plan was I was planning to write it. I'm kind of tossing that around and whether or not I want to kind of send an advance reading copy to somebody and have them write it, so it's kind of a third party view on it rather than my own, because I might be at this point a little close to it to have, I don't know, to be able to look at it in an introduction kind of way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You could do a little, it's always nice to have a little blurb somewhere if you can't, about whether it's in the intro or about the idea behind the book and, you know,
right.
Maybe inspired you. My thoughts anyway. But yeah, so we got 6 hours to go and $74 to go. That's just amazing. You were quite a ways away from that 2 days ago.
Yeah, the past 2 days, and we kind of expected it where the last couple of days would be all of the last-minute people who had kind of set it aside. I know I do it whenever I support Kickstarters where I'm like, let me think on that, and then I'll go look at it, and it has 4 hours to go, and I'm frantically trying to figure out which one I want to support.
Well, I find this both in eBay. The same thing happens in eBay bidding.
Totally.
Oh, Kim just wrote it on the message board. Hurry up, people. Pete's shirt isn't going to take itself off.
How close are we to the shirt coming off?
$74.
That's the 10,000 mark.
I know what I'm saying. How much is it left?
We're still at 74.
Yeah. Not that you'll be able to see anything, you know, with the I will let you in on a little secret. I'm not wearing pants.
You know, that's one of those Lovecraftian things that I didn't need to know.
No.
Something that, you know, can check.
What? We just jumped.
Mm-hmm.
$19 to go.
Oh, my gosh.
$29 to go. $29
to go. Who will be the last one? Let's see, what are the... Look at the sides. 5, 13, 25.
How do you spell Grimly again?
G-R-I-M-M-L-Y.
Yep.
Oh, wait. You know what? I'll do a little thing right now.
Oh, dear God.
I found this the other day at a bookstore, The Spawn of Cthulhu.
Oh, okay.
Somebody put us over and then email Mike, the first person to do it. I'll send this to them. And I'll send them a signed copy of Reanimators.
To the person that hits the 10,000?
Yeah.
Okay, got it. Somebody pledges 40 right now, they'll hit the 10,000. I feel like I'm on one of those
Telethon
things, yeah.
We got to get the dancing girls in here, you know, and maybe Jerry Lewis?
Jerry Lewis, that's who I was trying to think of.
The March of Dimes.
Yeah. Well, I really enjoyed having Ken on, too, man. He's really interesting to listen to.
He is. He's absolutely brilliant. And I was at his talk at the film festival, and I was just... I thought it was going to be a very dry talk, which they usually can be, you know? Mm-hmm. Keynote addresses can be often very dry.
We just did it. You just did it, Jeremy.
Uh-oh. Yay! Yes! Now I'll cover my eyes.
Go nice for it. You're at $10,041.
Fantastic.
Wait, is there a woman in the room? I hear a woman.
Oh, yeah, my wife is laughing along with us.
Oh, my God, that's great.
You this have a sweater on under your shirt?
Most interesting thing you've had.
Well, at least, Pete, you don't look like Wilbur Waitley undressed.
Well,
I'm not sure who to thank, whether it's Pete or whoever got him to know.
Well, you're climbing up now. Now you're at 10,111. So maybe you will hit that 13,000. So the 13,000, I'm not going to sit here until 13,000, but just that's the that's the interior illustrations one.
Right, yeah, and there's because there are so many stories, and that's really to have all of them illustrated. We've thought about whether we could do like a smaller or just having every other illustrated or, you know, a handful or whatever, and that might end up happening whether the Kickstarter grows from here or not. I always feel like in situations like this, in interior illustrations help the book. Helps break up because there's so many stories being told. It can help break up the cycle. So it would be cool to have them in there, but at this point, it's no longer a Kickstarter. It's going to be a book, so that's awesome.
Well, congratulations, buddy.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
Now I have to finish that damn story.
Yeah. And not let the secret leak between now and December.
Oh, man.
See what they're saying on the message board here.
All right.
Rodney Turner, my eyes.
It burns.
It burns.
It freezes.
Well, awesome.
Cool. Yeah, so let me know who emailed you first, Mike, and with their receipt or whatever. And
yeah, how are we going to know? Oh, receipt? Yeah.
I can actually, let's see.
Well, Jeremy can probably tell us who put it over. Don't say on the show, but email it to me.
Sounds good.
Or email it to Pete, whatever you want to do.
And you know what? I'll tell you what. If there's two that were really close, I only have one copy of Spawn of Cthulhu, so the first person will get Spawn and Reanimators, and the second person will just get Reanimators. But I'll throw something else in there as well. I don't know what, but I'll figure it out.
Thanks, Pete.
No, thank you for Mike for having us and letting us, you know, pimp our ride.
Right. and take off clothes. You know.
That's right. And it just keeps going up. It's up to 10,156 now.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, everybody. That's very much appreciated. Because I truly do think this is a great idea for an anthology.
Yeah.
Thanks. I appreciate everyone who has supported it and you guys for helping me pimp it.
Yeah, no problem. Well, Jeremy, thanks for being on the show.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Mike, thanks for hanging in there.
Oh, no problem. All right. Thanks, Rick. Thanks, Pete. And I will talk to you guys all in a few days, I'm sure. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Appreciate it.
Good night, guys.
See you Tuesday night at 8 Eastern.